Good evening, everyone. I can't tell you how excited I am to welcome you all to BTB Storyteller of the Year 2020 Awards, which is the first major event of Beyond the Box. You know, it feels so surreal. I can still think of that day in May 2017 when I had begun this with a small batch of 25 kids, you know, as a summer workshop. And from then to now, we've just grown from strength to strength, all because of your love and support. Often a lot of people ask me, you know, how did it all start? And how did BTB come into, you know, like existence? So that's, of course, a long story for some other day, maybe. But just to put it succinctly for you, I think this is something which was my calling, but you know, sometimes dreams chase you, you don't chase your dreams. That's what happened with my case. So when I realized that there is a real gap, you know, where I realized that, you know, a lot of kids, they are often, you know, they have this restriction that when they write something, they're always told this is right, this is not right. They have to always keep in mind the marks. So I realized that there is a real need of a space where they can express without being judged and where they can bloom to their full potential. Because I personally feel that all that the kids need is our belief, and then you can just see them blooming. So that is what I did at Beyond the Box. And thanks to all of you, because of the word of mouth and because of the great feedback that we received today, we have grown into something bigger than how I started. Now, BTB Storyteller of the Year Awards again was just a random idea which came to my mind one day when I thought that, you know, why not give kids a space where they can also narrate stories? Because during the course of my interactions with them, I realized that they actually love narrating also and not just writing. So that's when I thought that maybe, yes, we should think of something on those lines. And at the same time, I also wanted to have some video content which can help new writers learn on different aspects of creative writing. So what I did is I thought, let me have a YouTube channel where we can have a storyteller feature every week. And that storyteller wows you with their story. And that's how we started about 4 months back. And of course, on the YouTube channel, we also have different author chat videos. We, in fact, Beyond the Box has been the first platform in India to kickstart a virtual roundtable discussion series on different aspects of creative writing. So yes, this year we've been the pioneers of a lot of things. Another thing unique we did this year is the write-a-thon. So we've been the first platform to conduct an online write-a-thon. So yes, we are trying to live up to the name Beyond the Box by doing something beyond the box for all of you, just to give you that little bit of more excitement to bring out that creativity. Now, today's event, of course, we have loads planned for you. It is a special one. And as we proceed, I will be sharing more about the event, about what all we have planned. And I promise it is going to be an evening to remember. And I already see a lot of highs and hellos. Thank you so much for joining. So let's begin with some mesmerizing performances from our kids. So to begin this evening, we have Vihan Khandelwal here with us, who is going to give us a wonderful performance on the piano. So let's get him on the stream. Hi, Vihan.
Hi, ma'am. How are you?
I'm good, and I'm so good to see you. So Vihan, over to you. Please, we are just waiting to hear you.
Okay. Good evening, everyone. I am Vihan Khandelwal. Today, I'm going to play my piano and sing a song for you guys. I hope you enjoy my song for this award ceremony.
That I don't even need a single word I say.
Wow, that was amazing, Vihan. And of course, this is a virtual event, so we cannot hear the claps, but I can definitely tell you that people are loving it, which I can make out, you know, from the comments that we are getting. They are saying wonderful, lovely, wow. And you know, you've given a perfect start to this evening by choosing this song, because you know, that's what BTB is all about, right? We have only words to take everybody's heart away. So thank you so much, Vihan, for giving that perfect start to this beautiful evening.
Okay, ma'am.
Bye.
Okay. Thank you, everyone, and congrats to all the winners.
That's lovely. And yes, it's the fun has just begun for everybody who is watching us. So, now, of course, after this wonderful performance from Vihan, we have more planned for you. So Vanshika Goel is all set to wow us with her flute performance. So let's just get her on stream. Hi, Vanshika.
Hi, everyone. I'm Vanshika, and I will be playing a song called Teri Mitti from the movie Kesari on my flute.
That was beautiful, Vanshika. I actually was, you know, so lost, and I wanted more definitely. Maybe I think we should plan one day only for these musical performances and have a musical night. So thank you so much, Vanshika.
Thank you.
Okay, so now we have the next performer of the evening, and that is Vivan Bajoria, who is going to play a mashup of songs on the keyboard. So let's get him on stream. Hi, Vivan.
Hello, everyone. Hello, everyone. My name is Vivan Bajoria. I'm 10 years old, and I'm from BTS. I'd like to thank Anupama Aunty. She's a great mentor and guide. She has given us not only a platform in creative writing, but also in other activities. This is a small token of thanks to BTB and Anupama Aunty for giving us such a wonderful opportunity.
Thank you.
fabulous, Vivan. Thank you, actually. We should be thanking you for entertaining us. And there are some great comments for all the kids who have performed. So kudos to you all. And thank you so much for being a part of Beyond the Box. I think I'm feeling so emotional right now that I really don't have any more words to express. So thank you. Bye, Vivan.
Thank you and bye, everyone.
Wow, now that was amazing, isn't it? And I know that because this is a virtual event, I can't ask you all to, you know, clap. But yes, your comments, your shares, your reactions to this video is all, you know, it is equivalent to that. Now, before I go on to invite the chief guest for the evening, I just want to give you all a little bit of an idea of how we went about with the process of choosing the winners for today. We received 134 entries from across the globe for this particular initiative of BTB Storyteller of the Week for our YouTube channel. From those 134, we shortlisted and nominated 45 who were then featured on our YouTube channel. Now, choosing the winners among them was definitely a difficult task, but I must say that our jury panel did it with a lot of love and keen eye. So I would like to thank Netavi Banerjee, Piyusha Veer, and Namrata Sadhwani for taking out the time and for giving that effort, you know, to help us choose the deserving winners who will be announced today. So we will be announcing the winners in four categories. One would be the special mentions, which is based on the jury scores. Then there'll be the runners-up and, of course, the grand title winners. At the same time, we also wanted to acknowledge the contribution of those whose videos have been a real hit on our channel. So based on our YouTube channel statistics, you know, which we see on our dashboard, which involves the number of views, the watch time, and the audience engagement, we will also be awarding the popular storytellers of the year. So I'm sure all of you are waiting to know who the winners are, and you will definitely know the names in some time. There is also a surprise for the audience who are watching today. The one who engages the most on this live is going to get a surprise from us too. So yes, please keep commenting. You can also share, you can like, you can do whatever it takes. Everything will be counted as engagement. So yes, we have one surprise prize for also, you know, the most engaged audience member. Now, before I proceed, I cannot not thank, you know, some thank yous are definitely in order. So first, I want to thank our sponsors, My Playdate Community, Safe Campus, author Apeksha Rao and author RTV Raman, who have very graciously sponsored the grand prizes for the event. Then I want to really thank two people who have chosen to stay anonymous, who have sponsored money for this event. So they came forward and sponsored cash and said that we can use it to award the winners. So all the other winners will be getting an Amazon voucher, which has been sponsored by them. And unfortunately, they don't want their names to be revealed. So I'll just have to say that thank you, anonymous supporters. This really means a lot to me. Now, coming to the much awaited part of the day, here I will be talking to you all about my chief guest. You know, it is, I don't know what to say, because the chief guest for today is somebody who is very special to me, not just personally, even professionally. You know, she's somebody who is a great friend, but more than that, she is an amazing writer whom we all in the writing community look up to. She was also one of the jury members, and I'm really glad that she has taken out time today to be with us and share about her latest novel, Ashi. So let me get her on stream.
Hi,
Mitabi.
Hi, how are you?
I'm good, and it is so good to see you. I cannot wait for this conversation. But before that, let me just introduce Mitabi for all of you. So Mitabi Banerjee wrote for the first time when she was age 6, a small poem that stole the hearts of her parents and elders. She then did not know that her love for literature had been germinated. All she remembered was the smiles like any other child would. A postgraduate degree from CIEFL Hyderabad in mass communication and journalism happened in 2002, and she took up writing and editing in earnest. Creative writing entered a new phase in 2016 after a lot of writing had occurred as a blogger, a content developer, and a reviewer. And that is when actually I met her online and we became friends. Several of her blogs have been published on leading platforms of India like Mom'spresso and Women's Web. This phase culminated in her debut book, Aashi, for which she has been chosen as a finalist at the Coimbatore Literary Awards 2020. Apart from being a writer, she's also a developmental editor and the co-founder of Writers Collective, the niche publication house. She also teaches creative writing to kids as well as adults. Mithabi stays in Bangalore along with her husband, Pradeepto, and her two kids, Abhinav and Ridhima. So thank you once again, Mithabi.
I'm just too happy to be here today, Anu.
Yes, and I saw that you were enjoying the musical performances as well. Like I was watching you.
I love music and the kids were awesome. I mean, seriously.
Thank you. I'm sure they'll be very happy to know that. And so before we start talking to Mithabi about her book, she is going to be revealing the winners in the special mention category. So there are two winners in the adult category for special mentions and four in the kids category. So Mithabi, you have the names with you?
Yeah.
So maybe we can begin with the adults.
In the adults category, the awards go to Preeti Warrior and Daisy Bala.
Oh, wow. Congratulations. Preeti Warrior and Daisy Bala. You're the winners in the special mention category. Wonderful. Yeah.
And the kids category, we have Rhea Jain, Trisha Rath, Sri Harshika Ji, and Ananya C.
Wow, wonderful. Congratulations. Kids, maybe please have that virtual applause for all the children in the comments. So congratulations, Rhea Jain, Sri Harshika Ji, Trisha Rath, and Ananya C. So the children have been chosen among the top 10. And like I said, we received 134 entries. So I think this is a wonderful achievement. And in the adults, it is the top six. So congratulations, everyone. We will be reaching out to you soon for your certificates and also your Amazon voucher, which you have won. So thank you so much, Mithabi, for declaring the results. And so now let's start talking about Aashi. But you know, before we get to Aashi, I want to know that when did you realize that you really want to pursue writing in your life? Because of course, like we read in your profile that you did start writing as a child, but when was it that you really felt that, yes, this is something I want to pursue?
Ever since I wanted to do something, I mean, ever since I remember that there is something that needs to be done in life. You cannot goof up and, you know, go on here and there,
right.
A purpose, you know, you should have a purpose in life. I was also into a lot of public speaking, but somehow writing was a different thing, you know, for me all the while. So it happened very organically, nothing that I have planned. It's pretty much like falling in love. It just happened, and
right.
I moved along. I mean, various stages of writing, one after the other, kept happening, and things just flowed. I cannot point out actually when or where, because if I go back, I can see myself writing like 20, 25 years now. I think.
Wow. That's really a long time, and that experience shows in your writing, because I have read Aashi. So for the audience, you know, I've read the book, and you can really make out that, you know, this it doesn't seem like her debut novel at all. Like, I mean, I was like, oh my god, you know, like she's handled some of the things with such finesse, and definitely she's in form always, you know, anything you read that she writes. So tell me, Mithabi, this idea of the story, you know, Aashi's story, was it a story that was always, you know, sometimes we have these stories which are somewhat always there in our heads, and then, you know, they develop into something. So was it something like that in your case too? Or is it that like, you know, I mean, one day you thought that, okay, I need to write a novel, and then you started thinking about what story would it be? So just tell us, how did the particular story come into your mind, and why is it that you felt compelled, you know, to tell this story?
Well, I'll say Aashi is like an unplanned pregnancy, you know. I mean, it just happened. I conceived Aashi pretty instantaneously. Okay, so it was happening at around 2016-17, I was extensively writing for Mom's Presso, Women's Web, and all these. So Indraneel was mentoring me that time, and right. I was doing a lot of book reviews for publications, and I just sat in a coffee shop and I told him one day that I want to write a book. And he is somebody who never says no to anything. So he's like, haan, likho. So I said, no, I'm serious about it. He said, yeah, think about it. So if you have, since you have read, Ashi, you would connect to what I'm saying, that Ashi typically stands on three pillars. You know, it's about a woman's journey per se. I'm still seeing a lot of my friends who are professionally very well, but on the emotional front or in the personal front, there is an upheaval. I mean, that was something that I always wanted to write about. Also, secondly, I don't attach a lot of permanency with marriage. I don't know why when a marriage breaks, there is such a bedlam and, you know, blame games, and as if, you know, the sky has fallen. So my take always been that right from when we are young, we are taught that nothing is permanent in life, whether it is happiness, sadness, success, failure, money. Then why attach something to this? Two people are just not compatible, and that's it. I mean, you know, move ahead. This was one idea. And of course, the entire thing of love, that how love can be so unconditional and it can just, you know, make things work on a different platter. So I kind of amalgamated probably these three ideas, and Ashi came alive. And sometimes I'll also say this, that sometimes it happens, you know, a book writes itself. So
yes.
So when I started, somehow it you know, and the story kept on going, and things just happened, I'll say. It was not planned. Ashi, as a story, was not planned, but yeah, the ideas were definitely in my mind somewhere.
Okay. That's wonderful. There's a lovely comment. So, of course, we're getting a lot of comments, but this particular one I wanted to share because it's from a child. So, Rhea says, Anu ma'am and Mehtabi ma'am, you're looking pretty. So, thank you so much for noticing that, Rhea. Okay, wonderful. Yeah, so that is lovely. And you know, Mehtabi, because I've read the book, so what really caught my attention, which I've also mentioned in my review of the book as well, is the characters. You know, that all the characters, they are very real. Like, you know, they there is no glorification, there is no judgment also. You know, they make mistakes, they learn, and feel like people in flesh and blood, basically. You know, they're so real. Yeah. So I wanted to know that when you approach your characters, so was there like a conscious attempt from your side that you really want to make these people such that, you know, they shouldn't seem like hero, heroine in the conventional sense, but people that, you know, we can relate to, we can understand. Especially, you know, I want to compliment you on the character of Abir, because you know, there is always this thin line where we tend to, you know, show a man, like if you're trying to show a hero, we would try to show him like the savior, and, you know, like, so you've not done that. He's not somebody who is, you know, kind of coming and taking the stage. He's just there as an ally. So I think that was really beautiful. And I'm sure, which is why you're getting a lot of, the feedback on the end, but I think that's okay. So we'll not talk much about it now, but, I just wanted to know about your approach in creating these characters. How was that process like?
See, Ashi, as a character, you know, it's you and me or anybody. I think we all have a speck of Ashi in us at various levels. So Ashi was not difficult to write. It was not difficult to write. As far as Kaushik is concerned, if you have noticed that I have given a particular shade to Kaushik, but I've never said that he's right or wrong. He is what he is.
Exactly.
He didn't gel with Ashi. That doesn't mean he becomes a dark character. So I won't, because it happens. It happens in real life that we don't connect with somebody and we are very quick to say that, oh, vacha nahi hai. I mean, he is not good enough. But that may not be the case. We have seen that person might have a very good life with somebody else. sometimes right. it just becomes a compatibility issue. So no judgment. There was absolutely no scope for judgment for that matter. Coming back to Abir, Abir has created a lot of stir, I believe. I know my dad used to say, if you want to show something good, don't tell, show it. It's like when my kids were also born, they said, if you want to tell them that be kind and compassionate, do it yourself. They automatically yes. learn. Abir, I would say, is an amalgamation of all the good men I had in my life, like my dad, my brother, my husband, my mentor, my son, of course,
right.
and even a couple of my friends, male friends. So it's not that they're not flawed, but in flaws also, there are some good things that are worth a mention. So Abhi yes. was a gentleman, like you said, that he doesn't want to be a hero, but he is there. That yes. presence yes. itself is very assuring, I wanted to draw a kind of assurance from that character, that it's not that difficult to be good. You can be good yeah. in very yeah. simple things. You don't have to yes. lift the mountain yes. to be, become, yes. To be with a woman or help out a woman. Even just saying and being with her, I think it's good enough. So so that's how Abir was created. I don't know, but I never had a lot of difficulty with any of my characters, maybe because I was very clear about what I was writing.
Yes.
Yeah. Yes. And I somehow personally feel that the characters became very nuanced after, I think, 12th or 13th chapter. Before mm-hmm. that, it might be a little sketchy, but once Ashi goes to US and that,
yes, from
that
I agree.
Portion, from right. that portion, I think it becomes there's much more clarity in the narrative. I personally yes. see that now.
Yes, yes, yes. That's true. I agree as a reader that. Yeah. But I think that's how, a story also progresses, right? Because initially we look at characters, like you said, these are the things, the nuances when, it starts yeah. building up. That's what happened yeah. later. So, yes, I agree. So, yeah. there is a question from Vasudha Pansare who is asking if the paperback is available. Yes. All of you who are watching, Ashi is available both as a paperback and in the Kindle version on Amazon. We will also be sharing the link to purchase in the comments. And also, there will be a giveaway for Ashi post the event, which, of course, you will be able to find the details on our page. So, yes, please go and buy the book right now. Now I also see some people putting in comments that now, after hearing you, they are intrigued to check out the story. So I'm really glad. And trust me, guys, you won't be disappointed because I've read it myself.
Like I always say, ano jada ho gaya.
So Medhavi, as you all know, is of course a dear friend. So whenever we say all this, it does seem like okay enough. But truly, today I think as not as a friend, but genuinely as somebody who's read your book, I recommend this to everybody who's watching. And of course, please do share your reviews also, because I think for every author, review matters a lot. It could just be a single line that I enjoyed reading this book, and that I'm sure will make her happy. So now Medhavi, of course, we spoke about the characters and why the story came into your mind. Now tell me something through the journey of writing Ashi, because I have known that this has been a really long journey and I know how much effort you've put into it. So during the course of this, the entire thing, what was the high point? Of course, I'm sure the high point must have been when the book was actually out. But yes, I also want to know from you that whether apart from that, there was something else also which you feel is the high point. And what was the toughest part for you in this whole journey?
But still.
Yeah.
like you said, it's a journey. So there are a lot of things that happened. Since I have published it under a banner, so I generally put it up something like that: you conceive, you give a birth to baby, and then you raise it
right.
for the entire
right.
life. There's no respite,
Correct.
No respite. As far as low is concerned, I would say nothing much, but my health has been a bit of a deterrent.
Correct.
I mean, last September, October, almost 2 months, I was bedridden with a disc prolapse. I couldn't sit. So I almost thought that I would not be able to complete it. I would lie in a bed, put pillows below my knee and raise the laptop. And that's how I used to type. It was very painful. And by the time it was January, I got a frozen shoulder in my left shoulder. And by the time I realized that, no, this needs more attention than I thought. Mm. COVID has hit and everything went in disarray. And by May, even my right shoulder had gone for a toss.
Yes.
So by mid-May, I was like that Thakur and Shole, and the COVID standing behind me with like, "Ye haath mujhe dekhe Thakur." Anyway, these hands are of no use. No. I mean, it was very, very painful, and that bugged me terribly time and again. But okay, I'm still not okay, but I'm slightly better. So
yeah,
the health has been my low point.
I'm sure that's always a challenge, right? When you're not fine physically and in that kind of, you know.
And because of the COVID, I had to do away with my maid and cook, and it was completely
on me and my husband, and both
the kids, and it became extremely difficult. As far as the high points, I can't say one, but I'll just quickly say three. The first one is when my 11th draft of the novel finally got approved.
Okay, so this is for everybody who is watching, that the 11th draft got approved. And so I think this is actually a learning, you know, to be persistent and to be very patient, I think, to ensure that what you finally bring out for the consumption of the readers should be something really, you know, good. So yes, Metabi, I think that's hugely inspiring that you showed that level of patience and, you know, perseverance.
Yeah, you know, several times I have come and told you that I'm not going to write anymore.
I know, yes.
So when I submitted my 11th draft, you know, every time I did that, I used to prepare myself with chalo abhi 12th likhna hai. So something like that. So but then Indraneel text me that day in the morning saying that bahut acha likhi ho, bahut dil se likhi ho, and just put it for editing now. I think that was an extremely rewarding moment.
I'm
because
sure.
I look up to him and his mentorship. So that was extremely satisfying. Secondly, when the books came to my home and I wrote it on Facebook also, my daughter just kept on moving all around the house with the book,
that was
you know,
sweet.
And she
that was really
with
sweet.
The book besides her pillow, and I was that's a sight to behold. I think I'll all my life I'll cherish that. And thirdly, I guess when it reached my parents, I think that's priceless.
Oh, right.
That's priceless. My dad is 75. He doesn't see very well, but still he managed to read it. And I don't know how to express that.
I'm sure. That's some beautiful. Things, you know, you cannot express in words. But I'm sure all of us totally understand.
Yeah. So I think, in nutshell, I think these are the things which will go a long way, apart from everything else. These threes will remain extremely special for me.
Right. True. Very true. I would like to show you a comment. This is from Preeti Manaktala. So she says, lovely ladies, a warm hello. As Metabi said, there is a bit of Ashi in all of us, and there is a bit of Abir in all our known men around us. And fortunately, in our bitter has to now. Initially, I thought that's a typo, but then I realized that's not a typo and that's an intentional bitter house.
Thank you, Preeti.
Loved Ashi. Hugs to you both.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you. That was really a lovely comment, Preeti. And, I think that everybody will feel that, you know, and actually we have loads of comments. Unfortunately, due to time constraint, I'm not able to share it all. But Metabi, I'm sure you can go and have a look at the comments later on. Also, they'll all be there, you know, on the Facebook
video. Thank you, everybody, for joining in. That's special. That's very special.
Yes, yes. Yeah. Medhabi, I think, I think if we talk about Ashi, I personally feel that we can go on and on. Because we have to wrap up the discussion. So I want to wrap up by asking you that what is the kind of reception that, the book has received so far? Any particular feedback which kind of, really made you feel that, yes, the reader has got, what I had, set out to, the story that basically I had set out to tell, or anything which really touched you, if you could just share some of these, feedbacks or responses that you've been getting, something which you really liked.
First of all, Anu, that I think I'm immensely grateful and thankful to everybody who has picked up the book. I don't want to comment on anything or anybody in particular. I wrote it for the first time. I never really thought where would it take me. But the only thing I can say that it was a very, very honest effort from my end and a lot of hard work. So the very fact that it has been read and it has been talked about, it is being talked about, I think that itself makes me immensely happy. Coming specifically to your question about something, I think I will say this. I have a lot of people from the writing fraternity. We have a certain way of looking at the book. We become critical. We see the narrative. We see the development of the characters. We see the editing. But for me, probably, I was telling this thing to somebody else also, when a non-reader has picked up the book, several of my friends who are doctors, engineers, when they have picked up the book, they told me categorically, we picked up the book because you wrote it. But when we started reading, we couldn't put it down.
Right.
I think I'll put it in this way. It's like, I'm a very unlike bomb. I don't like sweets at all. So if you have to really make me eat a sweet, it has to be really good.
Right.
So, I will otherwise be like, oh, take care. It's okay. I don't need it. So if you are not a reader, if you really don't enjoy reading a book, for you to make, produce something that will entice an audience or a reader, I think somewhere I'm extremely happy that that has happened, and that has happened multiple times. Several people came who are not from the writing fraternity, and they just read for the love of reading it.
Right.
So I think that will remain very special. Not to say that I'm not counting in on the others. Of course, they are there. They are the learned people. They understand the nuances of a book. But the people who don't understand the nitty-gritties of a book writing or a narrative, they read just for the love of reading it. And when they come and say that we don't read books, but we finished your book in a couple of hours or a day or things like that. So that, I think, was extremely gratifying and very, very special.
Right. I am sure. Because, like you said, that just because of the relationship, people might pick up a book. But, the very fact that they really enjoyed it and were not able to put it down.
And I'll just add one more thing, that there's a funny thing about reviews, that the more they are similar, the more you know that it's correct.
You
cannot have discrepant reviews. Something saying something and something saying something. So with Ashi, even a writer, like what you have told me, in a more nuanced way, in a, dwelling deep into it. A non-writer friend has put it in a very simple way. Patapat ho gaya padke, fast tha, ending was this was that. And I know, but it's he or she has got it. That is the beauty of it.
True. I agree completely. Yeah. And I think this point you said is very relevant, that, the reviews being, because I did read some of the reviews it has got, and on some level they are similar, which is pointing to the fact that, yes, those things actually do work in the
story. That has come about. I mean, don't need to be somebody who is very, deep into reading to get those things. It was very evident, I would say.
I agree completely. So that it was really wonderful chatting with you, Mitabi, about you know, Aashi and your writing process. So thank you so much for taking our time,
thank
for
you.
Being with us here today, for gracing the occasion as a chief guest, and again for, you know, being one of the jury panels. I know it feels really weird to be talking of you as a chief guest for an event of mine, but the fact is you are. So today I'm not the friend Anupama, but I'm the founder of Beyond the Box saying that to you.
Thank you. I mean, it's an honor, it's a pleasure, and congratulations to all the winners, and keep writing, and write for yourself. That's very important. Don't play to the gallery. You write for yourself and everybody will connect you. That's something that I have learned, and I think that's a big learning.
Yes, that's a beautiful advice. So yes, all of you keep that in mind, that write for yourself and be honest to, you know, your writing. I think that's the best advice we can get. So thank you once again, Mitabi. And bye. And thank you so much to the audience. And all of you, please do check out Aashi on Amazon. As I said, it's available in both the versions. And we are also coming up with a giveaway, you know, on the book. So please keep following our page for more updates on that.
Thanks, Anu.
Yeah, bye. Okay, so that was a fantastic chat with our chief guest of the evening, Mitabi Banerjee. But we have lots more in store for you, as I said at the beginning. So now it's time for another round of musical performances. So sit back, relax, and enjoy the kids who are here to again wow us with their musical prowess. So right now, Janvi is going to perform for all of us on the harmonium. So let me get her on stream. Hi, Janvi.
Hi.
Okay, everyone. Over to you.
Okay. Hi, everyone. I am Janvi Angira, and I live in Pig City, Jaipur. I am 11 years old, and today I am going to play a Rajasthani folk song, Chum Chum Chumke, for you all on my harmonium. Chum 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 ke chundri mil jana re, chum 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 ke chundri mil jana re, koi thoro so, koi thoro so, mare sab chandri mil jana re, koi thoro so, mare sab chandri mil jana re, mare to lagde chundri mil jana re. Mari to rang de chudri mil jaane, mari sahi balu, mari piva jiru, mari sahi balu rang de ru mane re mil jaane, mari sahi balu rang de ru mane re mil jaane. Sare ga re sa tha sa sare ga re sa sare ga re sa tha sa sare ga re sa jo dhana sari kha sher me mil jana re jo dhana sari kha sher me mil jana re koi suno to koi suno to kare sunare re mil jana re koi suno to kare sunare re mil jana re payal ghar de bajne mil jana re payal ghar de bajne mil jana re mari nathni o mari nathni mari nathni barsharane re mil jana re mari nathni barsharane re mil jana re chum 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 ke chundri mil jana re chum 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 ke chundri mil jana re koi thoro so koi thoro so mare sab chandri mil jana re koi thoro so mare sab chandri mil jana re koi thoro so mare sab chandri mil jana re thank you.
Thank you so much, Janvi. That was beautiful. And in fact, we also have a lot of comments where people are saying that, you know, they love the fact that you chose the folk, you know, Rajasthani folk song. So that was wonderful. Thank you. And I really now feel that we should have a musical evening very soon at Beyond the Box after seeing you all perform. Okay. Bye, Janvi.
Nice meeting you.
Same here. Same here.
Bye.
Wonderful. So that was awesome. And I can see in all your comments also that you all are really loving these musical performances. So please keep encouraging the kids and appreciate them in the comments. Now coming to the next performance, which is by Riyansh Narula. And he's going to play the guitar, which is my personal favorite. So let me get him on stream. Hi, Riyansh. Riyansh, I think you're on mute, is it? Because your voice isn't clear. Could you just check that? Let's give Riyansh a couple of minutes to figure this out. You know, that's the biggest challenge of the online events. We have to work around these technical glitches. Riyansh, maybe what you can do, Riyansh, is you can probably try to log off and log in and just see. Sometimes even that works if it's not an issue of being on mute. So till the time Riyansh figures out and comes back, I can talk to you all. So I would like to once again thank our sponsors for the evening. The gifting sponsors are My Playdate Community, Safe Campus, author Apeksha Rao and author Aarti V. Raman. So the prizes that they have sponsored are, of course, the authors have sponsored their books. Safe Campus has sponsored a very interesting prize, which is actually a workshop on safety, which I think is very important in today's times. And they are going to equip you in a way that you can tackle the untoward occurrences in your life. And I think that particular workshop is something which all of us must undertake at some point. So we are very grateful to Safe Campus. This workshop is worth ₹2,000 plus taxes. So this is going to be won by the grand title winners. And My Playdate Community is also going to offer a creative workshop to the grand title winners in the kids category. So we are really grateful to all the sponsors and congratulations again to the special mention winners. And yes, there are going to be more winners that will be announced in the course of the event. So I think what we can do is, till Riyansh figures out his issue, technical issue, and comes back, let me get the next performers on board. And they are sisters, and a duet performance is always amazing. So let me get them on stream without wasting any time. Hi, Harshita and Akshita.
Hi, I'm Harshita. So, I'm 15. And I'm Akshita and I'm 12 years old.
Wonderful. So over to you both, and I'm just ready to listen to you both.
So today we'll be singing Count on Me by Bruno Mars. If you ever find yourself stuck in the middle of the sea, I sail the world to find you. If you ever find yourself lost in the dark and you can't see, I'll be the light to guide you. Find out what we're made of, but we are called to help our friends in need. You can count on me like 1, 2, 3. I'll be there, and I know when I need it, I can count on you like 4, 3, 2, you'll be there, 'cause that's what friends are supposed to do, oh yeah, ooh, 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 ooh. Count on me like
Wow, that was absolutely mesmerizing and so lively. You both are super talented. Thank you for entertaining us today.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Bye. Wonderful. So I think we have Rayanch back now on stream. So Rayanch, I hope we don't have any sound issue now. Sorry, Rayanch, we still cannot hear you. I'm really not sure why that's happening. So I guess, you know, there is probably some issue in the sound. Can you try logging in from another device? I don't know what may be the reason. Okay, so yeah, like I said, you know, these technical glitches do happen. So let's hope Rayanch is able to sort this out. So like, you know, so till Rayanch sorts this out. So yes, now very soon the next category of winners that we are going to be announcing is in the popular choice. And just to clarify once again, the popular choice winners have been chosen based on our YouTube channel statistics. So basically, you know, on our dashboard, we get the statistics for every video with respect. So it's not just the number of views, but it's also the watch time of each video. And it is also the engagement, the audience engagement. So overall, based on all these statistics, we've chosen the popular storytellers in the adults category and the kids category. And these names are going to be announced by our next guest speaker of the evening, who is here with us today. And Rupangi Sharma is our guest speaker for today. And I'm really excited to talk to her about her book. So just before I get her on stream, let me just check once again if Rayanch is able to manage this time. Hi, Rayanch. Yes, finally. Yay. So because I didn't want to miss the guitar. So yes, Rayanch. Over to you.
Hello, everyone. My name is Rayanch. I'm 9 years old. Today, I'll play the guitar.
Wow, that was fantastic, Riyansh. I'm so glad you were able to sort out your technical issue because I'm sure none of us wanted to miss this. So thank you so much, Riyansh.
Thanks, ma'am.
Bye. Wow, that was indeed amazing, right? And I can see that you all are thoroughly enjoying these wonderful performances from the children. And I must say, they are so inspiring. I mean, you know, when I was listening to them, I felt like, you know, that I should also learn some musical instrument now. So now it's time to invite the next guest speaker of the evening on screen. So I don't want to waste any more time, and I want to get this amazing woman who's an author, editor, and educationist on the screen. So here's welcoming Rupangi Sharma.
Thank you so much, Anupama, for calling me onto this wonderful platform, and what a fabulous initiative that you're taking, you know, to really get kids to express their imagination and show us all of what they have to offer. And I really loved Riyansh's soulful rendition right now.
Yes, it was indeed. Thank you so much, Rupangi. So just for the benefit of the audience, I will introduce Rupangi for all of you. Rupangi is an author, editor, and educationist. Her debut novel, A Life of My Own, is about gender bias, sex selection, and has already hit number 16 on the Amazon Hot New Releases chart. She has edited India Alive, a compelling volume featuring discussions among South Asia's most influential thinkers like Ramachandra Guha, Shyam Benegal, and others. Her non-fiction contribution has been published in the best-selling Chicken Soup for the Soul series. Her collection of poems, A Loving Embrace, was released by then Delhi Chief Minister, the late Sheila Dixit. Rupangi has studied education technology at Harvard Graduate School of Education and is the founder and CEO of EFG Learning, Education for Growth. She has spoken at Lit Fest like Tata Literature Live, the Mumbai Lit Fest, She the People Women Writers Fest, Think Literature Fest, and Think Woman is Power Fest. You can visit her website to know more about her, which is www.rupangisharma.com. She has upcoming releases with HarperCollins and Penguin, and we are definitely looking forward to them, Rupangi. So once again, welcome to BTB Storyteller of the Year Awards event.
Thank you so much for that warm welcome.
Okay, so Rupangi, so I want to begin by asking you that how did writing happen in your life? You know, the love for writing, when did you discover it? And then how did you, you know, decide to take it to, you know, a profession basically? Because sometimes, yes, we do write for, you know, just as a passion, but you actually then pursued it. So tell us about that.
Sure, Anupama, I'd be happy to share the journey that I took when I was very young, actually. I think I started writing by making cards and, you know, little greetings with poetry in them for my parents and for my cousins and things like that. And it went on from there to really, you know, discovering this love for any object to do with writing. So if I saw a typewriter, that was that, you know, there was this, just this force of attraction that I had towards a typewriter, for instance. You know, it was just a fascinating, magnificent thing that I just needed to have. It wasn't just about a computer, because I knew that, you know, typewriters are the way that all the very well-known authors have written their books. So maybe in my early adolescent years, I had already started feeling that pull towards anything and everything to do with writing. And I think wherever I saw words, I was reading it. Books were something, you know, trips to the library were something which were a given, because I really loved reading. And I was addicted to films, anything to do with storytelling, really. So I think it's just been such a great journey. And like you said, to take that and, you know, convert that into a professional endeavor. I mean, it took me a lot of research. So around my teens, I really started looking at different authors, especially female authors, you know, for me, because it was so important to have role models. So there was Chitra Devakarani Banerjee, with her fabulous books, and I would look up and see, okay, what? How did she become a professional author? You know, and then really look up even where she studied and things like that. And yeah, it was just fabulous. So I think it was just something that I always knew. It was something that I was born with, I feel, almost in some way. But I was fortunate to nurture and have that space to nurture it. And of course, my parents, my family, everybody has been encouraging it since day one. And I think that's really important as well, to get that space of encouragement, because a lot of us do have that talent hidden, or maybe it's there even in a very It's there, it's out there for everybody to see, but we may not have that option to pursue it. So I think that's really important to be able to take that stand and say, no, this is what I really want to do, and to pursue it.
Wonderful. That's wonderful. I also would like to share some of the audience comments. So Vasudha ma'am says, Rupangi Sharma, good to hear about your books.
Thank you so much, Vasudha.
And Chandra says, wow, Rupangi, such amazing accolades. I completely agree.
Thanks, Chandra. That's so great. Thank you.
Yeah. And this is a lovely comment from Pooja. She says, you're very beautiful.
Thank you. All of us are the lovely ladies of this of the hour, really.
Right. So, Rupangi, I would definitely want to talk to you about your book, the recent book, A Life of My Own. But before we talk about your book, I would like you to announce the winners of the popular choice category. So, Rupangi is having the names of the winners. So these are the most popular storytellers of the year. So maybe we can begin with the adults category first. So who is the winner and who is the runner-up?
All right. So I'm going to get this up on screen and little drum roll for all the suspense.
Right,
so popular choice.
We don't have drums, but yeah, we would have loved to do that.
Can you imagine it?
Yes, absolutely.
A little drum roll going up. And the winner is Nimisha Jambu Saria.
Wow, so Nimisha Jambusaria is the winner of the most popular storyteller of the year title. Congratulations, Nimisha. We will definitely get in touch with you soon for your certificate and the voucher that you have won. And who is the runner-up in the adults category?
And the runner-up is Vasudha Pansare, who I think commented and was interacting earlier. So Vasudha, thank you so much for that comment. Congratulations as well.
Congratulations, Vasudha Pansare. You are the runner-up of the most popular storyteller of the year. So let me just remind you all that both of these videos have got great audience engagement on our YouTube channel, which is why they are being recognized. And now we move on to the kids category. So, of course, because kids are always more participative, so we always have more number of winners when it comes to children. So here we have two winners and two runners-up.
All right. So I'm really excited to announce the popular choice kids category winners. The first one is Deva Ashrita Joyce. So we'll...
Wow. Congratulations, Deva Ashrita Joyce. Wonderful.
Right.
That's wonderful. Yes.
One...
I really wish I had those drums. Perfect.
Yeah, the drum roll effect, right? And the next one, and we'll just do the drum roll, is K. Shri Samskriti.
Wow. So K. Shri Samskriti and Deva Ashrita Joyce are the winners in the popular choice category for kids. And let me tell you all that their videos have got such fantastic, engagement on our channel. In fact, they have been the videos which have got thousands of views and comments. So yes, they truly deserve this honor. And yes, who are the runners up in this category?
And the runners up are Riyansh Parikh and Pakhi Raj.
Wow, congratulations, Pakhi Raj and Riyansh Parikh. And let me tell you all that Riyansh Parikh is the youngest storyteller to be featured on our channel. He is just 5.5 years old. And you must watch his video. You will be totally floored. He's so adorable. So congratulations, Riyansh Parikh and Pakhi Raj. So all the six winners in the popular choice category, you will be contacted by our team very soon for your vouchers and for your certificate. So thank you so much for doing the honors, Rupangi. And now let's talk about your book, which I'm very excited to talk to you about.
Super.
So Rupani, tell us a little bit about the book. What exactly, of course, we do know what the theme is. But yeah, if you could just share a little more about what exactly was the thought, behind telling the story and what is it about, if you could shed more light on that.
Oh, absolutely. It came from a very deep place, because it started off when my mom told me about my birth story, and she said that I was really excited to have a daughter. My elder brothers, of course, she had a son first, so she was really looking forward to have a daughter, and so she was so happy when she had me. But then there was this one detail which she mentioned, which really, somewhere I think it stayed for many years. So she said that the nurses, however, told me that we don't see a lot of people who are happy when a girl is born. So they were actually shocked to see that she was happy and that she was celebrating the birth of a daughter, of a girl child. And this is all, you know, upper middle class, and you've got these all hospitals which are really reputed. So it was very shocking to hear things like this. And I'm not the only person who has had to share this kind of a story. I have friends who've told me these stories of their own when their daughters were born, and, you know, either it was the maternity staff commenting like this. And then, of course, there are some very unfortunate mothers to be who have to go through a lot of discrimination because, you know, they have given birth to a daughter, or, you know, and unfortunately, really unfortunate. I mean, I feel so angry to hear about these issues. And I think that's what really led me to write this book as well. And I'm just going to put the book up as well. So here's the book. It's A Life of My Own.
Wow,
and it's
lovely.
About Shweta's, and it's about Shweta's story. Shweta, you know, has to go through this very traumatic time where her husband Rahul and her in-laws are forcing her to illegally determine the sex of the child. And you know, she's had a lot of a battle with infertility. So it's kind of, I think that son preference is something that the family pushes on to her as well, although she herself does not really believe in that, and she really loves the child, and she really wants to give birth to a child irrespective of the gender. And so it's her story of how her family, her husband, her in-laws are also you know, pushing her to illegally determine the sex, and putting that pressure and that kind of abuse which she has to really face. And, you know, these are all stories that I have read about and research that I've done with prominent nonprofits, and really going through all the case studies, which were really heartbreaking to read about as well. And this book is kind of born from that seed of wanting to reach out to women who might be in this situation. And there's no better way, and I'm sure you agree with me, Anupama, there's no better way to reach out than with the story. You know,
Of course, I agree completely. Yes.
Absolutely. And that was really what drove me to write the book, that there's this personal space when we're reading a book, right, which we're, it's almost like whispering thoughts into somebody else's mind and taking them onto a journey. And so I thought that this would be, especially because women who are stuck in this kind of situation, given that it's so highly sensitive and it's illegal, you know, may not have anybody to share these thoughts with or share their situation with as well. And so a book that inspires you to realize that there are other women who have faced this, there are other women who have faced much worse as well. But, you know, there is a way to get out of the worst of situations, and really, you know, with belief in yourself, with hope, and trust. And I know that there's your own personal story, of course, which is so inspiring, you know, that you have faced a lot of this as well. I think all of us have varying degrees, but to even see you and hear your story has been so inspiring as an entrepreneur, somebody who's really, you know, kind of held on to her dreams and achieved everything that you have so far. And it's so important for all of us women to do that and not use that faith and hope and belief.
Yes, absolutely. And, you know, I really agree with the point you said about, you know, ultimately it's the stories that we have to reach out to, you know, to influence, because I think, you know, stories do trigger that chain of thought in the heads of people. And in fact, I see a lot of audience is also, you know, like they are also agreeing with our discussion. So Chandra says she loves the cover, and then Jayashree, of course, is congratulating the winners. Manit says that most of the times the parents are happy, but the people around question the happiness, which is appalling. Yes, that's true. That, you know, it's there's a lot of societal expectation, pressure, and definitely very true. So Pooja says this is a nice topic to write on, and an important one, of course. So then there's also a comment from Geetika. This is amazing. Two strong women coming together for a conversation so required. Thank you so much, Geetika.
Thanks so much, Geetika.
Yeah. So, you know, so as we can see that all of us agree that this was such an important topic to write about. It happens. It's so rampant in our society. So when you were developing your characters in the book, what was your approach? Like, did you draw from like real life experiences? How did you go about, you know, your characterization?
Absolutely. So there were a couple of things which I kept in mind. One was that I did not want to highlight any particular community. And while it is true that there are a lot of communities which have a higher incidence of these kinds of, especially this kind of a social evil, however, it was important for me to really focus on the root cause of why this happens, and not just the social evil, but the fact that we actually propagate this in varying ways on varying levels on a daily basis, yes. Right? So it's really about that gender bias that we hold. So addressing that was really important. So I think even thinking of those things, as well as in terms of even fleshing out characters of men who stand up for women, I think that was really important as well, to show kind of a balance and a gender equality, that yes, there are on one hand, there are men like Rahul, but there are also men like Arjun and Sahil in the book who, you know, really, yes, you will see once you read the book, inspiring characters as well. So the idea was to show, you know, what a gender equal world could look like. And if we support each other, and I think it's really important also in terms of characterization and characters and just creating the world, right, that you bring into a story. True. To make it one realistic, but also a balance of what is reflected in the world. You know, there are, of course, a lot of gruesome things going on, but there are many, many stories of inspiration as well. And I think those are the stories that we need to hold on to in our darkest hours, right? So in terms of characters, yes, I did, you know, really base it on a lot of, one was research, case studies, nonprofits have written about, who are focused on this issue particularly. And I actually even attended workshops on how to communicate around this issue, because this issue is also very sensitive. So, you know, it's something that you really have to think through and really understand. It's not just statistical, but to understand the qualitative data. Right. And like you said, real life incidents. There were incidents, I remember one in particular, which is also a running theme in the book. I don't want to reveal too much, but a running theme in the book, which, you know, there was this story which really, really, it got me thinking, was about how this lady whose husband was a CEO or something, so very well educated. And of course, their names weren't given. It was completely anonymous because it's a case study, but how she had to go through multiple abortions just to have a son. And, you know, it was never that the husband was supporting. It was never that, it was just a given for her. And so this is also a health risk. So you're putting a mother-to-be or a woman at health risk, at a very high risk of, you know, all kinds of things if you continue doing abortions, which are not required, which are not necessary. You know, so that's the, that was something that really, and it is also reflected in another character, that is Shweta's mother. And so there's that relationship between a mother and daughter, and her own story and her mother's story is also quite, you know, disturbing. And it all just kind of, because I really thought about how does all of this, one is, you know, affect the psyche of a woman, but also how does it affect a family?
Right. It does. Yeah, exactly. That's absolutely right. Because it does not affect just the individual, right? Everybody in the family gets impacted in some way. Yeah. Yeah. That's wonderful. And that sounds like a very nuanced and in-depth, you know, I think, take on the characters. Like, I'm now really eager to read the book, actually, after listening to all of that. And yes, some of the audience members also are saying the same thing. So Rekha says, quite an interesting concept and long way to go, ma'am. Okay, so this is from Harshika, which is a child. She's one of the winners as well. She was a winner.
All right, Harshika.
Yes, and yes, that's indeed shocking, of course, you know, the way things happen. And Chandra says, that's a lot of research which has gone behind the book. Indeed, thanks, that's shocking. Yeah. So just for the benefit of the audience, I would like to tell you all that the book is available on Amazon in both paperback and I guess even in the Kindle version, right?
Yeah, I'm going to hold it up again. Yes. It's available. Yes.
So the book is available on Amazon, and I'm sure this conversation has definitely aroused our interest. So please go buy the book, share your review. As I said even earlier, that you know, even a one-line review means a lot to an author. So yes, do read the book and share your reviews. And as I said, we will also be running a giveaway on the books of our guest speakers of today, which we will be doing, of course, you know, in this week. So yeah, please keep an eye on our page updates. So now, we spoke about the story and the characters, Rupangi. Now tell me something that through this journey, right, I'm sure like, you know, once the book might have been out, it must have been like a really wonderful feeling for you, definitely. Was there any kind of particular, you know, feedback which you really like, something which stayed with you, or something that anyone said which really touched you, or you know, made you feel like overwhelmed? So just share some of these high moments with us.
Absolutely. I think the highlight for me were the many reviews that I got early phase, and it was just fabulous to get that kind of support from well-known names as well, both in entertainment as well as in writing. And so we had Kiran Manral's quote, we had Mahabanu Modi Kotwal, who's of course written and directed the play Vagina Monologues, among her many other, you know, roles as an actress, as a producer, as a director, and Narayan, who's written a revolutionary book called Chup. Also a TED speaker. So I think just wonderful women coming out, and most importantly, something that I was really excited about as well was Tara Sharma giving us her quote.
That's really lovely. I saw that.
So there's an interesting story there as well, because I knew her father, and I was addicted to his books. He's a writer as well, a playwright, and he'd written a lot of plays and books. And there was a particular series which I think would interest our young kids watching. It was called Detective Ranjha. Yes, Dog Detective Ranjha.
Oh,
it was about Ranjha is this dog who's, you know, who helps his not his owner, his more like family, you know, to kind of go on these little detective trips and sniff out everything. And being a dog lover, I think I grew up on these books and was really addicted to them. And so for her to support Pratap uncle also, when I was really young as a teenager, I think he also gave a lot of support. So just kind of that coming together has been a wonderful feeling, a very warm feeling. And in terms of reviews from, you know, people who have read the book, it's just been great to see everybody has been connecting on various elements. So there's also a slight magical realism twist to the book, which is that the god is speaking to the unborn child while the entire journey is happening. Okay. And so, there are people who have connected to that as well, that there's an interesting take on a personal god. Which I'd love for all of you to also read and let me know about your thoughts, as well as just the whole catharsis and, you know, just that this is something that we really want to read about. It's important. And more importantly, I also had men say that, which is I think the most interesting in some ways.
Right.
I just want to say this as well, Anupama, I'm sure you're aware of this, but something that I'd love to see is men reading more books written by women. And so social issues, just that, you know, we as women, I think we read men's books, and there's no bias there. I think we read anything that we like, I think it's just the other way around, that if women write, there's a certain perception of what that book would look like, or is it a good book, or is it about chick lit, and chick lit is amazing.
This perception that, okay, if it's a female author, then probably, like you said, you know, chick lit, or, you know, it must be something frivolous. So,
And also chick lit is a great, you know, no disrespect to
chick lit.
I absolutely love it. So, just to say that I think we should, So, all the men who are listening, I think that's kind of a message for all of you.
Yes, men who are watching, please do pick up Rupangi's book as well. In fact, we already have, people saying, so Pooja says she knows her mom's birthday gift. So that's, I think that is such a wonderful gift, you know, to give, I guess. giving a book is the best.
Absolutely.
Men should read books written by women. Yes, I'm sure all the women will agree. I think it's just about taking us seriously, because I think it is a fact we have to accept it that women writers aren't taken as, but of course I'm sure things are better and things are changing.
But we can always encourage it, right?
yeah, of course. They must, definitely. So yeah, that was a very good point. And thank you, Pooja, for choosing Rupangi's book as a birthday gift. I think I honestly feel that, I'm known as the bookwali auntie by my students, because I'm always giving books as, gifts. So I honestly feel that, books are the best gifts we can give anybody,
Absolutely. And you're a wonderful author as well. So I think we should be asking you lots of questions too.
About this. True. Yeah.
As well.
Yes. Definitely. So Rupangi, so anybody who picks up your book, what do you think, what can they expect? What would you tell them, that what is the kind of experience they might have? Is it would it require a lot of because some books are more breezy in tone, some require you to absorb more. So what is the kind of book that you have written with respect to the experience that so what can the readers expect from your book?
So this is a heartwarming, inspiring read. And those are the kinds of reviews that I'm getting as well, that, it's of course, it is an issue which is highlighting a social evil. And yes, there are moments which will be heavy. But overall, the tone of the book is heartwarming and inspiring. And I hope, I hope to provide that catharsis and release. Yes. To my readers. I think that's so important. You can only get it from a book, right?
Right. I agree. That's true. So before we close the discussion, Rupangi, one message for everybody who is watching us, who also aspires to, be an author. And I think in today's times, of course, there are many ways probably, by which you can actually go around releasing a book. But I think the biggest hurdle that all of us face is our own, sometimes self-doubts or apprehensions. So from that aspect, as an author yourself and as somebody who has accomplished so much in the writing career, what is that one advice you would give to somebody who's starting out? Because a lot of followers of Beyond the Box are people who have recently started writing. So something which basically the pearls of wisdom from Rupangi. Yeah.
Absolutely. So I think, Anupama, something that I have seen has been really helpful to me is to connect with other authors, and you're giving that platform to young budding authors to connect with each other. And hopefully when they grow up and they start publishing books, and I'm going to pick up all of them, they'll have a little network of their own. So I think one is that, to have that kind of encouragement and support like your platform is providing, and to keep to keep it going in some ways, because it's so important. It's so it's something that is so personal, writing.
There's
an additional layer of self-doubt. I think that, you're so critical of what you've written, and sometimes it may not be what you think it is. It may be far better than you think it is. And so it's important to also reach out to others for feedback and get that, from a reader. It's so important to let people read your work, let people give you that feedback, and then go back to the drawing board if you have to, and work on it. But it's like everything else, I think just working hard at it, having a lot of belief in yourself, and persevering, ultimately, I think is something that helps in any kind of vocation. But especially, I feel like a calling that is a high kind of calling in some ways, like writing.
Right.
You just need to go with your own feelings and believe in whatever your heart tells you about this story, this one story that you have. Believe in it, give it your best shot, and just put it out there.
Yes, very, very. I think that's great advice. There's also a question from Pooja, which she's asking that, can her 13-year-old read the book? So I'm not very sure, but maybe Rupangi can suggest.
So Pooja, I think this one is a little, it might be a little too complex maybe for her to read right now, but I'd love for her to read it maybe when she's in her later years, in her teens.
Yeah. Maybe 2-3 years down the line, because I think by then kids do become slightly more. Yeah,
absolutely. Yeah. And depending on the kinds of conversations the parents have already you've already had with your child, you know. But I am also writing children's books, so I'm going to be very happy to announce those as well very shortly, probably early next year. And so I'd be excited to have Pooja's daughter read that book, because it's non-fiction, but I'm very excited to be working on it currently, and very excited to release that next year.
Lovely. So that sounds very interesting, and we will definitely look forward to that book as well, and hopefully we will have you again live with us talking about that book. So thank you so much, Rupangi. It was such a pleasure talking to you, and it was indeed a very enriching discussion as well, and we are really looking forward to your book, to read it. And for the audience, so don't forget that there is going to be a giveaway on the book very soon, so keep following our page for the update on it. So once again, thank you, Rupangi.
Thank you so much, Anupama, for calling me here. Thank you to all the wonderful participants, giving us all that encouragement on the side and cheering us on. And yes, thank you so much once again.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Bye.
Okay, so we now have Aditya Goel on stream, and he is going to give us a lovely performance on the keyboard. So, Aditya, are you ready?
Yes, ma'am. Hello, everyone.
Okay, wonderful. So, over to you. Yeah, so over.
Hello, everyone. My name is Aditya. I'm 12 years old and I live in Hyderabad. I would like to thank Anu Aunty for this wonderful opportunity. Today, I will be playing a mashup of songs for you all. Hope you enjoy. Thank you.
Superb, Adi, and all of us, have enjoyed it. In fact, there are a lot of comments for your performance. Everybody has appreciated the mashup. You are fabulous. Thank you so much for entertaining us today.
Thank you, Auntie. Thank you, everyone.
Bye.
Bye.
Wow, wasn't that just amazing? I think the kids are these days super duper talented. I sometimes just wonder that they have so much of work to do at school and later, but still they take out time to nurture their own passions at that age. I think that's truly commendable. So thank you to all the kids who have wowed us with their performances today. And thank you to the parents. I think behind all this is, of course, the efforts and dedication of every parent who encourage their children to pursue their interests and learn different forms of art. I think art is what completes us. So thank you, parents, for letting your kids perform for us today. It was indeed a pleasure listening to them. And I'm loving the comments from you all. So just to remind you all, I hope you remember that the person with the maximum engagement in today's event from the audience is also going to get a special gift from us. Well, now, now we have two major sections of awards, waiting to be announced. So I have the results with me for the runners-up of the title. Now, so initially we had planned for two runners-up in the adults category, two runners-up in the kids category. But what happened is we realized that the kids are so amazing, I just couldn't, when we were coming up with these awards, I said, yeah, it is so unfair to just give like one winner, one runner-up when you have like so many amazing talented storytellers out there. So what we are finally doing is we will be giving two awards in the runners-up for adults category and three winners in the runners-up category for kids. And I'm really waiting to reveal that name to you. And this is going to be done by me right now. And yes, I see your comments. So Suman says, thank you, Anu and BTB, for giving kids this wonderful opportunity. It's absolutely my pleasure, Suman. And like I said, I'm not totally inspired to plan a wonderful musical evening at Beyond the Box for the children. Now, there is some nervousness. But before, I announce the winners in the runners-up category, let me tell you all that post that announcement, we are going to have an exciting storytelling session by Sonia Bareja, who is one of the most popular and sought-after storytellers of our country. She is facing a little bit of a technical glitch, which I'm keeping my fingers crossed. I hope she's able to sort it out. But till then, let us proceed with announcing the names of the winners. So I see that you all are nervous. Okay, let's see. So the runners-up for BTB Storyteller of the Year 2020 awards in the adults category are Subhashini Prasad and Chandra Sandeep. Can we have a huge round of applause for our winners? Both of them have had amazing storytelling videos on our channel, which has been loved by the audience as well as the jury. So congratulations, Subhashini and Chandra. We will be getting in touch with you soon for your certificate and for your Amazon voucher. So wonderful, great job done there. And it's now time to reveal the names of the runners-up in the kids category. And the runners-up in the kids category are Aditya Vaishnava Hazra, Ashi Panchal, and Somaya Gupta. All the three kids, huge round of applause for you. Congratulations. This is truly a great achievement. I think, because 134 entries from all across the globe, and to then be declared as, the runner-up, I think it is absolutely wonderful. So That's amazing. So yes, I would like to congratulate our runners-up winners once again. So Subhashini Prasad, Chandra Sandeep, Ashi Panchal, Soumya Gupta, and Aditya Vaishnava Hazra, well done. And one more thing I would like to tell our audience is what we are going to do post the event is all the winners, you know, whose videos have been featured on our YouTube channel, we will be editing the title of those videos. So right now they show as BTB Storyteller of the Week, but it will change to, you know, Storyteller of the Year, winner, runner up. So whatever title you've won, we will be editing the video to convey that. So congratulations. And I see a lot of comments where Pooja says that Soumya can't stop jumping. Yay! I'm also very happy for all the children. And congratulations to all the kids. Kudos. It's not a small feat, says Chandra. Yes, Chandra, and congratulations to you too. Your daughters gave a fabulous performance today, and now you're among the winners. So you definitely have loads of reasons to, you know, rejoice. And let me tell you all that all the winners will also be, you know, like revealed on our page as well. So we will definitely be announcing it even later, just in case, you know, somebody has missed these announcements or they have not been able to join for some reason. So this will also be declared on our page later. Well, so now I'm waiting for our storyteller who was supposed to be with us. And like I said, she has some technical glitch. So I don't know. I just hope she's able to sort it out. Let me quickly check with her if she's able to join. So till Soumya is, you know, kind of working, sorting out an internet issue and joining us, I want to ask you all that, are you enjoying today's evening? Do you think that Beyond the Box in its first event has truly tried to be beyond the box? I would love to hear your comments. So please tell me whether you're loving this evening, whether you enjoyed, because, you know, when I started with the thought of doing an event like this, it started quite small, you know, at that time. Like in a sense, I thought, okay, we will, you know, acknowledge the efforts of our storytellers. We will celebrate them and we will award them. But then slowly, you know, it just built on to something as big as today. So yes, yes, everybody, I see a lot of yeses there. Yay! So the excitement is high, and I'm so happy because Soumya has finally joined us. Yay! I was really worried. So let me get Soumya on stream. Hi, Soumya.
Hi, Anupama.
My God, you really got me worried today.
You can't imagine how much I sat on this guy's head.
But I am
as
sure. Luck
would have it. As luck
I know.
Would have
it. But I'm glad it worked out. You know, I think jo kehte hai na ki end mein achha hua to bas theek hai.
Shah Rukh Khan ka dialogue hamesha yaad rakhna chahiye na. Dil se chaho to puri kainat jud jati
hai. Haan, exactly. And I think aaj itne log dil se chah rahe the, because there are many people who have joined us today. And I'm really happy to see all the comments that people are loving the event. So I'm sure sabne dil se chaha tha ki abhi tak sab achha hua hai, to ye bhi achche se ho jaye. So wow. For the audience, I would just introduce Soumya to for all of you. So Soumya Bareja is an incisive professional with 20 years of varied experience as an entrepreneur, educator, cum counselor, storyteller, wellness coach, mentor, and sales and marketing professional. She's an internationally accredited mindfulness practitioner. Alongside, she also conducts sessions on sexuality and wellness with children and parents. So that's wonderful. And as I told you all, she's one of the most amazing storytellers of our country. And I'm really honored that, you know, she is here with us today for a small storytelling session to entertain us. So over to you, Soumya.
Wow. Thank you so much, Anu, for giving me this beautiful evening. And I saw a bit of it and then I logged out because of the connectivity issue. And since then, I've been trying to fix it up. I'm going to watch it completely on the Facebook later. So, yes, we have a story to tell. Now, the story that I have got for each one of you has traveled from far, far, far land of Europe. Yes, I have chosen to tell you a folk tale from Europe. And like all the stories, this story also starts like once upon a time. Yes. We know that each story starts like this. Once upon a time, long, long ago, there was a traveler. And if I were to show you how a typical traveler looks, this is how a typical traveler will look like. Yeah. Am I looking like a traveler? Yes. Yes. So there was this traveler and he was traveling for many days until one fine day he got tired and he found out that he had nothing left in his bag to eat. And he looked at his empty belly and he looked around. There was nobody, no shop, because he was traveling for a long, long, long time. And long, you know, long distance, when he was trying to look through, he saw some light and he realized that, wow, light means there is some living beings there. And yes, he walked towards that light and he found out that there was a decent village there. And then the traveler was happy and he just went up to one house and he knocked. Nobody responded. He again knocked and shrieked, opened the door and came out an old looking woman. And he looked at him up to down. He said, "Oh, what do you want, gentleman?" The traveler smiled and he replied and said, "I'm a traveler. I just need some help. Would you care and would you share some food and place?" The old lady just squinted her eyes and slammed the door on him and said, "No, I don't have any food to share. I don't want to care." Our poor traveler just didn't lose hope. He went to another house and he again knocked. This time, the door opened and came a little tiny boy with chocolatey eyes. And this traveler smilingly greeted him. "Hey, young boy." And the young boy looked at him. "Yes, uncle. What do you want? How may I help you?" And the traveler said, "My little young boy, all I need is a little help. Would you care? Would you share some food and some place?" The boy said, but uncle, we don't seem to have any food. Please leave," and slammed the door. By this time, the villager had thought and had seen that house after the house he went, no one was ready to give him food. Everybody would open the door and talk rudely and slam. Can you hear me?
We can hear you, Sonia, but we can't see you. Yes, okay. Now we can.
Yeah. Oh, okay. Some connection issue maybe. Okay. So then the villager thought that these villagers needed something more than he needed. And it was not food, but it was some magic. And he looked at his empty belly and decided that, I'm going to give a big learning to the villagers. He sat on the top of the top cliff of a mountain and started screaming from there, "Listen, listen, listen! I am the master cook and I'm going to make something magical. As magical, as delicious, and as edible, and as nutritious. If you want, come and savor this magical stone soup." He screamed from the top that he was a master cook and he is going to make magical soup. The soup, my dear ladies and gentlemen, my dear youngsters and not so youngsters, is going to be nutritious, delicious, incredible, edible. And if you wish, you can savor this soup. And then, soon enough, an old-looking man came with the biggest pot, a big, huge, gigantic pot, and he handed that pot to our traveler and said, "Here is the pot, gentlemen. Now tell us and show us what is this magical soup you're talking about." Well, the traveler smiled and took that pot and said, "Wait and watch." He took that cauldron, he poured a lot of water, lots and lots of water into that pot, and he lit the fire and he kept that cauldron on top of that fire. And very soon the water started to boil and there was a steam of the water. The steam of the water has its own aroma. The whole air filled off that steam of nothing but the water. And our traveler started to pretend as if he was smelling something really delicious. "I simply love the aroma. It's the magical soup. I'm going to put my magical stone into this." Quite sheepishly, he took a normal stone which was lying on the ground and he pretended that he was picking it out from his bag. And he picked it out like this and dropped it in the cauldron. Dum! And he started stirring. Ding, 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 ding. And he started singing. Ding, 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 ding. And the aroma kept on coming and he kept on sniffing. "Wow, the soup is delicious. The soup is incredible. It could only become better if I could put some carrots in it." And then he realized that nobody gave him food. He also said that, "Well, in this village, who would give me carrot? No one gave me food, no one cared, no one shared. But I'll still hope." And then suddenly he saw that lots and lots of people, the villagers, were started to gather around him. They all wanted to see what this magical creation would turn out to be. And one woman amongst them just handed over a few carrots to him and said, "Here, I just have a few carrots with me. If you want, you can take these from me." And he just cut those carrots, put them in the cauldron and started to stir. Ding, 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 ding. Ding, 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 ding. And again sniffed. "Wow, the soup looks nutritious, delicious. Incredible, edible. Only if it could become better only if someone could give me potatoes." And then came another woman holding a bunch of potatoes. And she said, "Here, I have a few potatoes. Do you think they'll help?" And the traveler smiled with glee and said, "Bring what you have got. Put them into the pot. I'm making the stone soup." So the lady took all the potatoes and dropped it in the cauldron. He again started stirring. Ding, 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 ding. The soup looked delicious. It would become even more nutritious if someone could lend cabbage. And then an old looking man came with two big cabbages and said, "Oh, gentlemen, I have these two pure, fresh cabbage, the leaves, and they are very fresh. They are from my backyard. Do you want them?" The traveler said, "Bring what you've got and put them in the pot. I am making the magic stone soup." And then the old man gently dropped both the cabbage into the cauldron. And then the traveler again started to stir and said, "The soup is almost going to be ready. Only to make it more delicious, if someone could bring herbs and spices. But in this village, who will get herbs and spices? Then a young lady came enthusiastically and said, I have lots of fresh herbs and spices from my garden. You know, I grow them in my backyard. Here they are. Do you think they'll help? The traveler smiled and said, bring what you got. Put them in the pot. I'm making the magic stone soup. And the lady nicely and gently put one spoon of the herbs and lots of spices. And finally, the aroma was genuinely delicious. And the soup was ready. After so much of brewing, the soup was ready. The traveler now announced that, bring your chairs, bring your tables, bring your bread loaves, and the soup is going to be ready. All the villagers went inside. They rushed back. They got their chairs. They got their tables. They also got the bread loaves. They got the meat. They got everything. And the whole village was feasting. And everybody was served with this delicious soup. And the traveler was served with meat, bread loaf, and everything he wanted for. He also got some food packed for him for next few days because he was a traveler. And the women of the villagers thanked him and they enjoyed the marvel of the soup. They told the traveler to visit their village again and make this beautiful soup again. On this, the traveler said, well, you now know the recipe of this magical stone soup. All you need is the stone that I'm leaving with you. This magic stone you all can keep. And then remember, you all have to come together, collaborate like a team, and put all the ingredients, whatever you got, put them in the pot and make your stone soup. And the only magic recipe, the only magic ingredient that you all need to remember to put into the pot is sharing. And with this, the traveler picked his bag and said goodbye to all the villagers, and he was on his way back to his travel journey, and he started humming the song, Musafir ho yaro, na ghar hai na thikana, mujhe chalte jana hai, ha, bas chalte jana. With this, I would rest my story, and the title of the story was The Stone Soup. It's a very famous European folk tale. I hope you had enjoyed the story. Thank you so much. I love you all.
That was amazing, Sonia. You really took us there. You know, I mean, I'm sure all of us could smell that soup. And in fact, you know, a lot of people have commented how much they loved your story narration and the story. So I'm sure you can check out all those comments later. Maybe I'll just share a couple of them for you. Okay. And I must say, which is something even one of the audience members is saying, that you are actually a very good singer too, which is something even I didn't know.
Thank you so
much. So even
much.
Chandra says the same thing, that you sing as well as you narrate. Awesome. Absolutely love the story narration.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
And Charu says, wonderfully expressed, kept me hooked.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much. It was lovely. I would have loved to meet all of these beautiful people in person. But Anu, we know that, you know, we are trying our level best to, you know, be with them, whichever way.
Correct. Yes. I completely agree. And I just hope that maybe next year the situation would be better. And, you know, the next time this event can actually be a real event, as in, you know, not in the virtual space, and we can have you talk to people personally. So let's hope for the best. So thank you so much, Sonia, for gracing this event with your presence. And now Sonia is going to reveal the grand title winners. I think that is something that has been much awaited. So, you know, the winners in the category of children and the adults. So we are eagerly waiting, Sonia. So maybe you can begin with the adults. So who are the two grand title winners in the adults category?
Wow, this is like the biggest thing you could have given to me, Anu. I mean, imagine who doesn't like to announce the winners and increase right. the competition in the audience. And I know, you know, you when you announce a challenge, my God, there is a race in children and adults to kind of participate. And I have personally done it. My daughter has done it. And I mean, it's a wonderful thing that you're doing for all of us us. So three cheers to Anu and BTB. Now, without wasting any much time, we have two winners. If I was in person, I would have also asked for any guesses, but right now I'm not doing that.
Yes, unfortunately, we cannot guess. Yeah.
So the first winner is in no particular order. The first winner is Haritha Kannan.
Haritha Kannan is one of the grand title winners in the adults category. I see her online. So congratulations, Haritha. And yes, who's the other winner?
Congratulations. And the next one is Gauri.
Gauri Bhargav and Haritha Kannan have won it. We cannot have a loud cheer, so let's have a lot of comments for them. The virtual drum roll. So congratulations, ladies, you are amazing storytellers and you have won the title of BTB Storyteller of the Year 2020. And now let's hear the names of the winners in the kids category. We have three winners in the kids category, so
yes, three winners in no particular order. The first is Shrikar, the first child.
Shrikar Chitta. Yes. Wow. Shrikar Chitta. So Shrikar is on a roll. He just won something yesterday and again he's winning this today. Wow. Congratulations, Shrikar.
Wow. The next one is Sid Verma.
Sid Verma, congratulations. So I think Sid Verma doesn't live in India, so probably he's not able to watch his name getting announced. Okay. But I hope he'll catch this later. Yes. And who's the third winner?
And the third is Anshika Kodukula.
Wow.
Yeah.
So congratulations, Shrikar, Anshika Kodukula and Sid Verma. You three are the grand title winners. BTB Storyteller of the Year 2020. Wow. Congratulations to everyone. And thank you to the jury who helped us choose these deserving winners. So thank you, Mitabi, Piyusha and Namrata once again. And thank you, Sonia, for doing these, for, you know, honoring us with your presence and announcing the names of the winners.
Totally my pleasure, Anu, and thank you once again to you, to BTB, and to all the prestigious jury and people who are who work as a team with Anu. I know it is not possible by one person, but hats off to Anu, who kinds of shells out, takes out time, and is extremely creative. All my love to you, girl. And a lot and lot of love to all the audience. I'm going to stay back and now enjoy the balance of the program, Anu, while you get the other speakers or other people. Yes.
Okay. So bye, Sonia. So actually, we are going to wrap up. So you were the grand finale of the event. That's why you... So thank you. Bye, Sonia. And it was really lovely having you.
Same here. Love to you all. And have a very happy Diwali, everybody. And have a very safe Diwali. Stay indoors, stay masked, and stay safe. Play with lots of colors and diyas this Diwali. Bye-bye.
Yes. Bye.
Yeah.
Wow. So that is like, you know, I think it's such a wonderful moment. I was getting goosebumps when the winners were being announced. So once again, congratulations to all the winners. And truly, you know, I mean it from the bottom of my heart when I say that even if you did not win today, you're still a winner, because I feel that just coming out and telling a story which touches the heart of people, I think that itself is a win. And I hope all of you will continue to associate with Beyond the Box, with all our initiatives. I hope you will continue to keep, you know, send us your stories. There are lots more events and initiatives that we are planning for you in the coming weeks. And for those who missed this, you know, event this year, like I know a lot of people came and told me that, oh, we were not aware, or, you know, we kind of missed the deadline. So don't worry, we will be opening again. So of course, for this year, you know, we have closed the entries for the Storyteller of the Week series, but we will be opening again in January. And definitely, I look forward to a lot more videos and lots more participation from all of you. So thank you so much. You all have been a lovely audience and I thoroughly enjoyed hosting this event for you all today. Once again, I would like to thank all the performers. The children were really amazing. I want to thank the jury. I want to thank all our sponsors. And all the people, you know, who make Beyond the Box what it is. I call it the Beyond the Box family because that's what we are. So I'm grateful for all the love and support. So keep showering that on us and keep growing this family, because what happens is, you know, I think Beyond the Box has grown the best with word of mouth. So just keep doing that. Keep spreading the word about us if you think we deserve it. So bye, everyone. And I will look forward to you sharing about, you know, this event, your experience. And just, you know, we are always eager to know where we can improve. So bye. Take care. Happy festive period. And I will see you very soon again with another event. Bye-bye.